Hey everyone, Mike Wolf here. Thanks for tuning in again to what I like to call the top 10 mistakes Canadians are making when investing in the United States. And so the reason we're bringing you all this is I want to shorten your learning curve, get you investing without making these mistakes. A lot of these mistakes are ones that I've made in the past myself. And there's no need for you to make these same expensive mistakes that I did. Unfortunately, I learned the hard way because I started investing in the U.S. Before anybody else that I know of in Canada was doing it. And now everybody wants to do it because it's kind of the sexy thing to do. The U.S. market's way, way down. Opportunities are crazy, but a lot of Canadians don't know what they're doing. And so I'm hoping to help you around all those landmines. So today what we're going to talk about is not having a power team. And actually, in addition to just saying a power team, I should actually say a good power team. And the operative word there is team. Team is a very important thing. So what that means is you don't just fly down to Phoenix or Orlando or Atlanta and, you know, call up a realtor because they come up first on the Google search, and then you call up a property manager because they come up first. Basically, you need people that work together. You're basically building an assembly line, and if this person over here isn't cooperating or communicating properly with person here or person here, you don't have a team, and you're going to have a big mess, and you're going to always be changing people, and that's costly and time-consuming. So what I want to do is go through some of the different people you're going to require on your team. Depending on what city you're in and what strategy you're doing, you may need more or less people than this. So we're going to talk about some of the most common elements of what I call my assembly line and explain to you what their role is and how you might be able to find some of these people. So we're going to start off with a cross-border accountant, because before you even start investing in the U.S., you need to know what kind of structure you're going to be putting these properties into. What type of entity? Are you going to put the properties in your personal name? Is it going to be a Canadian corporation? An American corporation? You need to figure this out beforehand. Although, having said that, if you're buying your personal name and you decide you need to go in a company after the fact, you can do what's called a quit claim deed. I'm not going to go into great detail on it, but it allows you to basically move it from your personal name to your corporation quite quickly and easily. And there won't be too much negative implications with doing that, as long as you just have one or two. If you're trying to switch over and you've bought 20 properties, you've got a big mess on your hands if you decide you need a different structure. So better to build your foundation properly first before you get going, and then start building your skyscraper from there. You don't want to build a big skyscraper on top of a really poor foundation, because it's going to come crumbling down on you and you're going to be in big trouble. So start with that. Find out what it is that you're going to be putting your properties into once you get them. So secondly, you're going to need a currency trader, because if your money is in Canada and Canadian funds, we need to get that money down to the U.S. And if you use your bank, and if you tune into my previous videos, you know that they're charging you some high fees to do that. It's very, very expensive. So why make the banks richer? I don't feel bad for banks. Matter of fact, one of the things I teach my students, I do mentoring, and I teach my students to be the bank. There's two ways to make money in this world, in my opinion. And one is to be involved in real estate, and the other is to be the bank. So I can teach you how to do that. Matter of fact, what I teach is to use your liquid cash for buying real estate and your RSPs to become the bank and be a mortgage holder. And I can teach you how to do all that. If you have any interest, let me know. So anyway, your currency trader is going to save you a lot of money in moving your money from Canada to the U.S. and back as well. So keep that in mind. So number three, realtors. Now, in most of the cities that I work in, I don't use realtors on the purchasing side of things. So what I'm going to use a realtor for is basically to help me to determine value of a property more often than not. So if you tuned into one of my previous videos, we discussed how there's only really two ways, in my opinion, to get a really good idea of what a property is worth. And one is through appraisers. And of course, you have to pay them each time that you do an appraisal, so it gets very expensive if you're looking at a whole bunch of properties. So you might only want to, you want to use them very, very sparingly. But realtors can do a lot of the work for you, and so they're going to do what's called a CMA typically, and that's called what stands for a comparative market analysis. And they're going to look at other properties similar to the one that you're trying to determine the value of. And they're going to show you some other properties that have sold, hopefully recently, because if you go back too far in time, that information is meaningless, and show you the value of the property. So I use them for that, and sometimes I use them on the disposition side of things when I'm trying to sell the properties. And so the realtors that help me out to determine value are the ones that get my listings when I go to sell. So keep that in mind. If you are buying in the MLS, I'm not saying there's anything wrong with that. You're probably going to pay more than you have to. There are better ways to obtain properties. For instance, I like to go to the auctions. I love tax deed auctions. I actually teach a course on how to do that. I like to buy short sales. Very ineffective strategy if you're just trying to buy one or two properties, but it can work really well if you're trying to get a lot of properties. And if you have a long-term approach and you have time on your hands, because it does take a while to get these properties. You can also look at bulk REOs, which is REO stands for real estate owned. That's where the bank owns these homes. They sell off big packages of homes. There's also wholesalers. I wholesale properties to clients. There's a lot of different ways to get properties. Usually the MLS is not the cheapest, but in some ways it's the safest. So if you don't want to learn some of the due diligence steps, which I recommend that you do, we're going to talk more about that in a future video. But if you, you know, just said, I'm going to get one property, I don't care if I pay a little bit extra, it saves me some of the steps. You could still get in trouble on the MLS, but there's less pitfalls unless they go into the auction. So the auction is a whole other course that I give. So anyway, a realtor is an important part of your team. I have one of those in every city that I work in. Some has more than one. This got eroded a little bit by our sticky, but this is supposed to say mortgage brokers. And mortgage broker, in the States, it's very difficult to get financing at the moment. Now, that's eventually going to loosen up. The banks obviously only make money when they lend. They don't get paid to have their money sitting there doing nothing. So they will get looser as time goes on. We do have some lenders that lend every now and then. It's kind of a moving target trying to get financing in the States. So you may also want to have a mortgage broker on your team in Canada that can help you leverage what you already own. Maybe you have some equity in a property here in Canada, or you need a line of credit. You're going to have a lot more buying power as well. If you bring cash to the States, you're paying cash, you're going to get a much better deal. If you write an offer on a property for $100,000, subject to financing as a condition, and I put in an offer for $80,000, no conditions, 99% of the time, my offer is going to get accepted, even though it's much lower than yours. The banks just want the stuff off their books. They just need this stuff gone. And they're not going to wait to see if you're going to get your financing or not. They're not going to even deal with it. They're not going to look at it. So my recommendation right now is to get money up here in Canada as much as you can, either from the banks or the private sector. I offer courses also on getting private money. Get money up here, bring it down to the States, pay cash, and then after you own the property, then try and do an equity takeout. Get some of the money out of there so you can build up your empire and buy more properties quicker. So that's my recommendation to you. Next is contractors. Of course, a lot of these homes are distressed. You sometimes are buying them as is. They're typically going to need some kind of work. At the very least, they're going to need cleaning in a lot of cases. But I try to avoid really beat up homes. It's way, way, way discounted because there's so many homes to choose from. I'd rather have something that just needs cosmetics. Maybe it needs paint. Maybe it needs carpet. So having good contractors that you can trust that are going to show up, because that's always a challenge, and they're going to give you a good deal, especially if you're absentee and you're not actually looking at the properties, they could go into the property and say, oh, it needs this, 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 and this. So for me, I've got several people on my team that are double checking. I've got my realtor who's going to look at the properties. I've got my inspector who actually should, I didn't put that on the list, but you should have an inspector. I've got three or four different opinions on what needs to be done in the house. I've got people taking pictures for me. And you need to be really careful because if the contractor doesn't really know you that well, but he knows that you're out of town and he knows you don't have anybody checking up on him, you don't know. They could tell you, oh, you need new carpets when you don't, and collect money for it and never put them in. So lots of things you have to be careful of. But once you have some good contractors on your team, take good care of them. Pay them well. I mean, within reason. You don't want to pay them ridiculous amounts of money, but you certainly want to keep them happy. And they're also worth their weight in gold if you can find good ones that show up and that care about you and see the long-term picture. So I'm doing a lot of different properties, and my contractors don't want to lose that deal that they've got with me. So they're going to take really good care of me. But if you're only buying one property, it's a little bit more difficult. So the good thing for my students and my clients is that when I send my clients to these contractors don't treat my clients as if they're buying just one property. They're looking at it as, hey, Mike's got lots of clients that have dozens of properties, so they take good care of us. So another really important part of your team is a property manager. And these guys are hard. It's hard to find good property managers these days. So you have to be really careful. You have to be really diligent with that. You want to get references. You want to find out how many properties you have under management. You probably don't want somebody who doesn't have a whole lot, because that's might be a little scary. You probably don't want to have somebody who's got, you know, too many, unless they have a team of other property managers working for them. Because if they're, you know, managing 1,000 doors, you know, you're not going to get a very responsive property manager when you need help with something. So once again, there's a lot of room for property managers to take advantage of you if they know that you're up here in Canada. So they may say, oh, the property's vacant, and they may tell you it's vacant for months on end. They may be collecting cash under the table. So I'm not trying to scare you and let you think that everybody's trying to rip you off, because it's not typically the case, but we do see these sort of things happen. So once again, I'm traveling to a lot of the cities that I work in almost on a monthly or bi-monthly basis, and I've got other people on the ground to check up on these properties to make sure that if a property is sitting vacant or supposedly sitting vacant, that it really is. So these are all people that you need. And then the last one is mentors. And sometimes this will save you a lot of time and money if you have people that have already gone through this process and can help you get around all the landmines and hurdles. So these are really important people in your life. It's kind of like an example I like to use is a Rubik's Cube. And if you don't know how to solve the Rubik's Cube, and somebody were to show you step by step how to do it, after you're shown once or twice, you're able to do it on your own. And so same thing with your mentor. Your mentor should be able to get you around all these curveballs, get your money and you working as fast as possible to start making the returns that you deserve and make more money. So very important to have somebody helping you, unless you have all this knowledge and you can do it yourself and you have the experience. But if you're first starting out, you might want to, you know, pay a little bit extra and have a mentor to help you through this. So these are some of the people you're going to need. Each city is going to be different. Each strategy is going to be different. Sometimes you don't need all these people. For instance, if you're going to a tax deed auction, you're actually attending the auction yourself, you're not going to need a lot of these people. You're going to be bringing, first of all, you're going to be bringing cash with you to the auction. You may need a realtor to basically give you some market values prior to, but maybe you're buying stuff that's already fixed up, maybe you're not. So you don't always need all these people. So you need to determine what it is you're trying to achieve and what pieces on the assembly line that you need to complete your goal. So very important to kind of map this out beforehand. What does your assembly line look like? Who are the people you're going to need to make your dream of getting these properties a reality? So these are all some of the people you need to keep in mind, and I hope this helps, and I look forward to seeing you in the next video. Thanks for tuning in.